Hey YouTube, this is Firewizard23 here to do another book review, and I'm going to give you my thoughts on Auntie Mame and Irreverent Escapade, written by Patrick Demas. I should first talk about how I came to know this book, because the original publication year of this story is, was it 1955 is the original publication year of this story. And it was subsequently made into a very famous movie starring Rosalind Russell as the titular Auntie Mame. And I learned about this story and this character through the Rosalind Russell movie, and then I came back and actually read the book. I would say they're almost equal. I would say the book is almost equal to the movie and vice versa in terms of how funny they are. Spoilers. This is one of the funniest books I've ever read. I have read very few books that do comedy very, very well, because it's extremely difficult to get across in literary form. Comedy works very well visually. It's very hard to portray comedy in the written word, at least the gut-busting laughter comedy. But this author completely succeeded only through the escapades of his Auntie Mame that he's describing. The story takes place from the viewpoint of the young Patrick Dennis, who upon his father's death, he is sent to live with his sister, his father's sister, his Auntie Mame, Mame Dennis, her full name. And the initial situation that is set up is a bank has control of all his money, but she has all of the responsibility. But she has all of the responsibility of taking care of him, making sure he goes to school and all that. She is not interested in that. She is interested in that, but in her own way. She is completely batshit crazy. Mame Dennis is a completely batshit crazy character. The term used by the book is madcap, but she is out of her freaking mind when the housekeeper for Dennis's father brings him to 12 Beekman Place? I believe that's the name of the place. I believe that's where he goes. I believe. 3 Beekman Place, I beg your pardon. The first major plot point is the father actually dies. And he's brought to the place. She's having this whole she goes through these different modes where she likes different things, and she's doing this whole Japanese party, and there's a breathing dragon on the front of her door, and this is set in the 1920s when the story starts. And everyone's having this great party, and everyone's drinking. And I believe it's supposed to be taking place during Prohibition, and this is happening. She's just having this party just completely out of nowhere, just completely in front of everybody. She's having at her place, this huge drinking party. And she has this Asian housekeeper named Ito, and because they knock on the door, just after being a little frightened at first at a breathing dragon, because they're fairly coming from a fairly conservative background, knock on the door, you want? And the maid explains her purpose, I'm here to deliver young Patrick to his aunt. Oh, yes. Come in, madam, having an affair. It's literally what happens in the book. It's so funny and they're just looking at each other like, what have we gotten ourselves into? And even Mame believes that they're the kitchen help and like is just not even paying attention. And finally, Ito's like, no, mistress, this your little boy. And it just suddenly occurs to her what's going on, and even she kind of got a date wrong and stuff. But what is it, the great, is it back here? It's like one of the opening lines where Patrick realizes, because he doesn't realize that's his aunt at first. She looks vaguely familiar, but he doesn't recognize her. And she's like, why, I'm your Auntie Mame! And gives him a hug, and then I knew I was safe. Because she's a very loving woman just in her own way. And the entire book is basically just a bunch of different scenarios of how just completely insane she is. She's told to, like, send him to a very stuffy school where he'll be raised Protestant and stuff. And she sends him to this alternative progressive school where he's being trained by a pair of nude teachers. I'm kidding. And the, Mr. Babcock, who is the trustee of all his money, he's trying to make sure that his father's wishes are being carried out, and he finds out he actually goes to the school, finds out where he is, goes to the school, and is in the middle of this completely nude activity going on in the classroom, and pulls him out in just enraging anger. I can't believe this. And ships him off to a private school. And during that same time, the Great Depression hits. Auntie Mame's rich, but she loses all her money, but she still tries to maintain... She, like, goes through all these different odd jobs, and we hear about how they all ended because she was just basically kind of out of her mind and couldn't really do her job properly. Something that's actually cut down greatly from the movie version, where they only show, I think, like, 4 jobs she took. She actually did... It's like, I swear there's, like, 30 in that chapter of jobs she goes through, ultimately ending at Macy's. And through the events that happen at Macy's, she loses her job again, but she meets a gentleman named Bo, who's from the South. And it's a Christmas where they barely, like, have any money, and, like, things are looking just so grim, but Bo actually tracks her down, saying, you know... Basically, he's become infatuated with her. And then there's this whole sequence where they go down south, and she's trying to woo his family, and there's this competing Southern belle who wants to basically knock her out, who get her out of the picture so she can marry Bo, because she wanted to be part of the family. And plays out very, very stereotypically, by the way, because it is the 1920s, 30s, so it does play very, very stereotypically. There are very stereotypical things going on in the South. They end up having a fox hunt, and through just a completely complicated set of procedures, she ends up having all of them like her. Through just a complete accident, something really unusual happens during this fox hunt, and they realize what a great person she is. And as the younger brother puts it, of this competing woman, "My sister's an A-number-1 bitch." It just doesn't even... You have this kid who just doesn't even have any morale. Can't even have subtlety about it. It's so funny. And I forgot, I passed something, but there was a sequence where she's also tries going into acting. I guess she used to do acting, but she had to go back to it just to try to make money. And even, like, her best friend, by the way, Vera Charles, completely, like, passes out at all her parties all the time and is waking up with a hangover in her apartment every night. It's nuts. But this book does not shy away from dirty language, by the way, if I have not made that clear. There's no filter in this book, so you better be ready for this. She messes up this whole theater performance, and Vera's, like, really pissed at her, and she calls her, like, a fucking bitch or something like that. She's, like, really pissed, and they totally toned down from the movie. Oh, wow, they had to tone this down, because she was mad. then she meets Bo, and she goes to the whole thing in the South. She ends up marrying Bo. And they do this whole world tour thing, and Bo unfortunately does pass away. I think it's a different circumstance of his death in the book from the movie. I cannot remember what the book's death is, but it's like he was trying to do the right thing, and unfortunately something just terrible happened, and he died. There are sequences of... Oh, God. There is a stenographer in the book that is purchased to help write Auntie Mame's story as she lived her life on Patrick's behest. Something just to kind of keep her occupied. And through a set of just really complicated circumstances, the secretary becomes pregnant, but she's like a complete sow's ear. But she gets pregnant without being married, and that's like a really big no-no, like you don't do that. Auntie Mame tracks Patrick down while he's still in private school. He's going to a private school now. And wants him to hide her while she's pregnant. And he has to like sneak out of the private school and bring them supplies and stuff to keep... this Agnes Gooch to keep her, she's pregnant, she needs certain things so they can keep going until the baby arrives. And Patrick's like, "You want me to escape school in the middle of a private school, these really stodgy private schools that have like, you know, demerits and all that stuff?" And they've got this story of like what Agnes will say if someone asks her who she is, and her response is, "I'm not even kidding." She is going to say, "I'm Mrs. Patrick Dennis." She's going to say that she's married to this high school kid, private high school kid. And one thing leads to another. The entire freaking town and school find out what has been going on and find Agnes, you know, pregnant and unmarried in this 20s, 30s environment. And her first thing out of her mouth to all these people, I'm Mrs. Patrick Dennis. Even though Auntie Mame afterwards is like, yo, enough of that. You know, our cover's blown. You know, it doesn't matter if you say that or not. But then everyone believes what she said, and like they have to throw Patrick out of school. You know, there's no precedent for this. You know, what do we do? He got a girl pregnant. And complete Deus Ex Machina. Somebody comes in and like totally just saves the day. Like a periphery character of that part of the story just comes in and saves the day. And then we see Patrick in college, and we see actually one a complete thing that was deleted from the movie version of this, where Patrick's in college and he's dating a hooker, but now he's 18. He actually has control of all his money and stuff, and he's like really socially popular in the school. And Auntie Mame, what kids would do if they're in college? You know, they go home to their parents and they do a laundry there and stuff. And she starts to get really, really connected with the boys and stuff that he hangs out with. And because of all the worldliness and traveling that she's ever done, Patrick starts to look really, really worldly. Like, wow, like, you have somebody who's really done all these things. You must be a really worldly person. This is also a really rich school. Auntie Mame starts, like, dating or seeing one of his friends. And he's trying to... And the stripper... The hooker wants to come to his school, like, the social gathering, while Auntie Mame is coming with one of his friends. And there's this whole social blow up of him trying to hide the fact that he's dating this hooker, and he's trying to reconcile the fact, like, why are you dating one of my friends? Oh, it's so funny. You have to read it. It's so funny. It's all just complete clusterfuck. It's terrible. He tries to marry this girl named Gloria after finishing college, because she's rich, she's well connected. And through, I would probably consider one of the most, not so much racist piece of text I've ever read, but the use of the word kike is used here, to refer diminutively to a Jew, is used in this book. I've never seen that word before. I can only assume that's what it means. Where these people are very stodgy and very Christian or Protestant, and they will not have people like live next to the house who are Jewish and stuff. And they start to have this whole fight about... Like, they get into the war effort that Patrick might be going off to war soon because the draft notices are coming in. And the draft notices are happening because the attack on Pearl Harbor already happened. And I forget the exact circumstances how it happened, but it is revealed very clearly that, you know, these people care about money, but they're also just these incredibly shallow people who are like... To one point, I think the father of Gloria actually is like... Because Auntie Mame is counterpointing how, you know, she's kind of defending Jewish people, saying, you know, she knows wonderful people who are Jewish, who are, you know, this great cello player she knows, and all these people. And the father of Gloria is like, you know, well, there might, you know, I'm not going to have any kike in my house. And she's like, do you know there are, you know, there's a man in Germany who's trying to exterminate all those people, all these, you know, these poor Jewish people. To which he responds, yeah, and I don't think he has such a bad idea. It's like, Jesus! Like, so... And the whole point of it is that this, you know, this is totally a poor match for Patrick. This is not the family he wants to be married to. So he calls off the engagement. He does actually go off to war. He comes back in a year. We're still following Patrick. He comes back. Auntie Mame has decided to contribute to the war effort, as Auntie Mame should. She adopts these six British whelps, these British children, because kids were sent off to the country and stuff for their protection during the war effort. They are little hellraisers, and we have a bunch of sequences of her trying to corral these kids, and just they're complete hellraisers. Just imagine the most obnoxious, malicious children, you know, just these horrible sequences. And the one final one where, like, a bomb explodes in the attic of his house. It's awful. The final of the sequence... Well, there's two final sequences in the book. One of them is with... they go off to, like, New England somewhere... Maine, I believe. They go off to Maine. And Patrick... Auntie Mame kind of... I believe this is meant to be a manipulation on Auntie Mame's part, where she's found these three French women who are, like, really, really stuffy, and, you know, we're important because we're this family, da-da-da-da, who are, like, incredibly artistical and sexual and stuff, and Patrick's basically just getting a raging boner just looking at these girls. And... And in this small New England town, there's also a young lady who works the tavern, whose name is Pigeon. And throughout the course of that act, there's some kind of blow up with the sisters, and they're pissed at each other, and like the town finally says, you know, you're nothing. Will you grow up? You know, just all this posturing ain't doing you nothing. And Patrick ends up leaving that chapter with Pigeon, sailing with Pigeon for her off to school. And in the very final act of the book, we see that he's now reached adulthood. He now has a 10-year-old son named Michael. A 9- or 10-year-old son named Michael. We've kind of come full circle with the story, and he's come to visit his Auntie Mame. And Auntie Mame essentially hoodwinks them into allowing her to take Michael off to India with her all the way through the summertime, and hopefully she'll bring him back by the day in September. It's either Memorial Day or Labor Day. I think it's Labor Day. This is one of the funniest books you will ever read. I absolutely 100% recommend this story. It's a very long story, but it doesn't feel long. I feel like it goes on for just long enough, because you really do want more. You want to see just how ridiculous this woman's life gets, how much she just completely complicates everything in her life. But she's having such a blast with it. It's never actually spoken in the book, and it was something that bothered me, because I think there is a line in the movie version of Auntie Mame with Rosalind Russell that culminates her character. Life is a banquet, and most poor suckers are starving to death. That is really her line, and I can't believe it's an edit with all the other stuff that's still in here, but the apparent original line was, you know, life is a banquet, and most poor sons of bitches are starving to death. You know, live. The message is live. It is the complete message of this book is live. Please go pick this up. You will love it. I'm Firewizard23. Take care and bye-bye for now, everybody.